Welcome to Jersey Guy Sports, your sports talk home for the Yanks, the Rangers, the Giants, and the Rutgers Scarlet Knights. I'm your host, Don. I want to thank you for listening. Now, today I'm going to be talking about one thing. The Giants need to draft a friggin' quarterback in the 2024 draft. So let's go ahead and get started. And that's the thing, right, guys? Whether you're Daniel Jones, you're a loser. The Giants, you're a loser. And for our fans, we're tired of losers at this point, right? And I'm going to talk about the need for the Giants to draft a quarterback in the 2024 NFL draft. And let's face it, guys, even before Jones' knee injury, his inaccuracy and his inability to remain friggin' healthy were reason enough for the Giants to select a real franchise quarterback in this upcoming draft. But this is before whatever this current friggin' injury is. He could be out who knows how long. But the bottom line is we need a real quarterback, and today's podcast is going to be dedicated to that, right? It's really just about the size of it, though. My thoughts on the play of Daniel Jones are pretty well known at this point. And if you're a listener of this podcast, it's pretty well documented. Probably there's a dozen or more podcasts with me talking about how I am not a Daniel Jones fan, and how I think we really need to get a different quarterback. And I've said it many times, and now it seems like the whole world is saying the same thing. It took them long enough, but it sounds like everyone is catching up. Let's talk about why, right? If in case you haven't heard any of the previous podcasts, or maybe you are not the biggest Giants fan, you catch them every now and then. Certainly, we have to acknowledge the team around Daniel Jones, and that's usually what the defenders start with, right? Daniel Jones certainly has not had a very good offensive line for almost his entire tenure as a New York Giants. He was drafted in 2019. This is 2023, 19, 20, 21, 22, 23, 5 years of just disgusting to maybe below average offensive line play for the Giants, and it's range in that range and nowhere above it. And let's face it, it's very hard, I understand and acknowledge, to do very well when your offensive line is not great. That's acknowledged, and that's been well documented, and that has been the armchair quarterback excuse as to why Jones has not done well. The offensive line has been bad. How can anybody do well with that offensive line? Great. Lack of receivers have been another excuse, right? And this is not, these are not falsities. These are just what people are saying is the reason Jones isn't good. I don't agree with that, but these are valid reasons and they need to be discussed. The Giants have not had, you know, excellent wide receivers, big, big playmakers that can help out Jones. This is all true as well. And you have to acknowledge that, you know, at some point, and not having a great line, not having playmaking wide receivers is going to be a detriment to any quarterback. And I fully acknowledge that. And if you listen to all the previous podcasts, I acknowledge that as well. What has to be looked at and what should have been looked at over all these years are there are times with the line play where there is protection, where there are open receivers, where there is time to do things. And those are times where Jones needs to do better and has needed to do better and has not. When you have a pocket and you have an open receiver and you miss him, or you throw it slightly behind him on a crossing pattern so that he has to stop, and instead of getting to 9 yards for a first down, he gets 6 yards because the linebacker was able to catch up and make a play. Or you throw a screen play that's just to the inside instead of the outside so that, again, you know, an inside linebacker, you know, moving from the inside out is able to get to the person and not lead the receivers properly like you should to allow folks to get the maximum yardage after catches. There are lots and lots of things you can look at. These things that I'm talking about, people may not notice, but you can feel them during the game. And when you see other teams and other quarterbacks and other yards after catch, it's because the quarterback is putting the ball in the right spot, not just completing the pass, but putting it in the right spot. Right. And there are, the same goes for long passes, right? If you slightly underthrow a bomb, you may complete it, But now he's not getting a touchdown. He's getting 40 yards, right? They matter, right? The one or two extra yards on the throw might be the difference between a nice 40-yard gain and a 75-yard touchdown pass. So while it's hard to sometimes distinguish that as fans, if you're a really, you know, if you're paying attention to stuff, you can see that Jones simply does not have some of the accuracy and certainly some of the instincts, which I'm going to talk about in a minute, as other NFL quarterbacks do. And when I talk about instincts, I want to talk about moving in the pocket, right, and throwing in the pocket. He has, I'd say, bottom half of the NFL pocket instincts and maybe even lower. But more than that, when he does move or try to get out of the pocket, oftentimes it's always, okay, now I'm going to break out of the pocket and that's it. He's running. And I've said this on previous podcasts where a lot of quarterbacks, and Tyrod Taylor did this, moved a little bit in the pocket, shuffled to his left or to his right, and kept his eyes downfield. And that's a critical thing that I don't feel Jones does enough of. Many, many times he's just looking to run and not looking to throw while on the run before he crosses the line of scrimmage. And if he does actually throw in those circumstances, it's often not accurate and certainly not in the good spot, like I talked about, that will maximize yards after catch. And good or great quarterbacks completely do things differently and are able to complete passes, you know, and put them in the right spots in those particular situations. And I want to apologize again for my voice here, guys. I was at a Rutgers game Saturday, and today is Monday, and I'm still not recovered from yelling. So if you hear a cough or you hear other things, it's because I yelled. Everything got out of my body during that Rutgers game Saturday afternoon against Ohio State. Back to Daniel Jones, right? Importantly, all those things I mentioned, right, are true things. They don't have the best offensive line. In some cases, it looks terrible, like yesterday against the Raiders, opening day against the, you know, Dallas Cowboys, and many other games, right? The line isn't there. Great quarterbacks rise above their team, and they rise above these friggin' excuses. And that's what they are, right? Just because something is true does not mean it's not an excuse. It's true that the Giants don't have an offensive line that's good enough. It's true that they don't have great playmaking receivers. Those are true. They're also excuses, right? You can have those things on your team and have quarterbacks that are able to make something out of nothing if you're good enough. And Daniel Jones just isn't good enough. And I'm sorry, there's plenty of other quarterbacks that don't have good offensive lines that rise above and make something happen. And it's time, guys. It is just time. In the NFL, you have to have a great quarterback if you want to win a Super Bowl. You do, almost 100% of the time. I mean, somebody might be able to, whatever, write me like they do sometimes. It's just, you know, oh, well, there was this one year where this thing happened. Yes, it's possible to win a Super Bowl without a great quarterback. You know, the Ravens have done it in the past, and there's been a few other examples. But, you know, you go back and look, and boy, oh, boy, you know, there's so many years out of the last 20 or 25 where the team that won the quarterback had a really, really good to great quarterback. Certainly the rest of the team and defense is good too, but great quarterbacks are necessary in the NFL, and the Giants don't have one, and the Giants don't need one, and the Giants have to draft one. To that end, the Giants are 2-7 after Sunday's brutal, disgusting loss at the Raiders, 36, which is just still unbelievable. My favorite part of that was tackling our own punt returner. That was awesome. We're 2-7. And Jones might now have a potential ACL injury on top of everything else. Might keep him out the rest of this year. He's having an MRI, I think it's today. So we're going to know more soon. But whether this is an ACL tear or not, it doesn't matter. It doesn't matter. Daniel Jones has had two neck injuries already that have caused him to miss significant time. And now some knee injury that will almost certainly ensure he misses a lot more time. Whether it ends up being a friggin' ACL tear or not, I don't see Jones coming back anytime soon. So the bottom line is this, right? His play alone, without anything that's happened injury-wise, was enough impetus for Joe Shane. And now that you add the fact that Jones can't friggin' stay healthy, and there's really no argument to me that seems valid, that would have the Giants continuing to stick with Daniel Jones as we go forward, right? there just isn't a valid argument that, you know, a person can say. You know, you have to be able to, you know, make the right decision, stand back, take a 10,000 foot view of your team and say, what do we friggin' have here, right? He has not been able to stay healthy. He's had two neck injuries. Now he has another knee injury. He's only 26. If you're that young and you're that hurt all the time, I'm sorry. I don't want to hear the excuses. I don't want to hear the offensive line. I don't want to hear it. What I want to hear is we have a great quarterback, you know, in a year or two from now and move forward from there. So with that in mind, the latest draft order, and obviously this changes every week with who wins and who loses. The Giants right now sit at fourth. We're 2-7, as I mentioned, after that ridiculous loss to the Raiders on Sunday. Right now, the Arizona Cardinals are first. They have the first overall pick, and they're 1-8. The Bears, believe it or not, have the second and third picks. One of them is from a trade, right? So the Cardinals and then the Bears have the next two, which is just, boy, I think I almost want to be a Bear fan at this point. And then the Giants have the fourth pick at the moment. Now, the Bears and the Giants and the Patriots are 2-7. One of the Bears' picks is from the Panthers, who are 1-7. So, you know, the Giants would have to do some nice tanking over the last couple games to get higher in the draft order. By the way, the Rams are 3-6, and there's a bunch of other teams with three wins, you know, there. There's 11 of them, basically, that have three wins or fewer. So the Giants have two. There's 11 teams with three. So the fight for the top draft picks is on, and the Giants really need to make sure they stay up there. I don't think they'll have a problem with that. I really don't see the Giants winning a lot of games. Now, knowing the Giants, what they'll do is they'll win some shitty, stupid game in December to knock them out of a better draft pick, and they'll get, you know, not be in a position to do what they need to do. But the bottom line is, right now the Giants are in a position to do something. I think the Cardinals, Arizona, could draft a quarterback. They have the number one pick right now. The Bears could pick a quarterback, even though they drafted Justin Fields just a couple of years ago. The Patriots, I don't know, could pick a quarterback. They're right up there with the Giants at 2-7. So there's some teams that are up there that do need quarterbacks, right? And it's funny how every year the teams that are at the top of the draft need quarterbacks. Why are they at the top of the draft? Because they have the worst record. Why do they have the worst record? Because they don't have a friggin' quarterback. It's amazing how that works, right? So, yeah, the Giants are right up there with those teams. The top quarterbacks that are available right now, and this is per Pro Football Focus, Caleb Williams, right now from USC, is the also the consensus number one overall draft pick, but he is also the top quarterback. It's weird, though. Every USC game I watch, and I haven't watched that many, USC ends up losing the game. So hopefully, you know, Caleb Williams is what they say they are. You know, if he goes to us, and somehow, you know, I feel like we're not going to get that number one overall pick. Caleb Williams is the number one overall quarterback available per PFF, Pro Football Focus. Next up, PFF has North Carolina's quarterback. His name is Drake May. Third, they're listing Oregon's Bo Nix. And fourth, they list Washington's Michael Penix. And again, remember, Caleb Williams they have is going first overall on the board. And they're listing May, who is the kid from North Carolina, going third overall in the first round. They have Bo Nix from Oregon going 19th and Michael Penix going 21st in the first round. So Pro Football Focus lists four quarterbacks that will be taken in the first round. The Giants absolutely should be in position to take one of those four. The fact that there are at least four potential first-round quarterbacks out there means that, A, as I mentioned, the Giants should be in the draft position, and B, there's some talent out there, and it's a pretty decent quarterback year. So that's a good thing, and it bodes well for the Giants. Certainly, if the Giants somehow win a couple more games and slip down in the draft order, there's a need for Shane to make some moves to get back up in the draft order. We just got a second-round pick for trading Leonard Williams. I think we need to use draft capital to do the needful here. We absolutely have to get a good quarterback. Now, which one of them should we get? Which quarterback? that depends on a lot of things. And I'm not really going to offer a solid opinion now, but maybe we can talk about for a minute a few factors that are involved in which quarterback the Giants should draft. Number one, as I just mentioned, how high will the Giants draft? That's a factor in who we can, because obviously we can only get who's available. Are we going to be first overall, number three, et cetera? Where do we land in the draft? Given that the Giants now do not have a healthy first or second string quarterback, remember Tyrod Taylor's out too, and the Giants are basically starting a practice squad quarterback at this point, right? Tommy DeVito for the foreseeable future. The Giants' chances of being very high in the draft are pretty damn good. Again, the Giants being the Giants, they'll win like one ridiculous, stupid game and drop like three positions, you know, between now and the end of the year. I guarantee you. And 100%, the Giants should tank to get there. You know, I know fans want to win every game, and fans, it's, you know, what are we going to watch? And we buy these tickets. And I think you really have to take a long-term approach here, guys. And no one wants to see your teams lose. Never, ever, ever. I've discussed this in other sports as well, but you never, ever, ever want to see your team lose. But you have to look at the big picture here. And the Giants have to have a high enough draft pick to fix this team, right? Say the Giants win five more games this year, some ridiculous way, and they end up with 7 wins. They will be pretty much out of position to probably take a quarterback. I mean, they might be able to move up and, you know, make some moves and trade away a lot of, you know, but why is that worth it? In what world is getting, you know, a couple more wins this year worth the future of your team? We know this year is gone. We know the Giants aren't doing anything in 2023. So why should we care about the number of wins or losses this particular year? What we should care about is how the hell do we get better? The way we get better is we get the hell rid of Daniel Jones and we get a good goddamn franchise quarterback in here who can lead this goddamn team. So the first factor is how high will the Giants draft? Another factor might be how good is each of these quarterbacks? Again, I'd have to watch more tape. I really haven't seen enough. The one person I have seen a fair amount of is the Washington quarterback, Michael Penix. And that's because he used to be on Maryland, as you guys might remember. And Maryland is in Big Ten, and Rutgers played them a lot. And you guys might remember many games from Penix and Maryland. There's a really famous game where Maryland ended up beating Penn State, and there was a famous play at the end where Penix took off and dove for the goal line, and the ball hit the pylon, and you know, Maryland upset Penn State. Penix is really a dynamic quarterback for sure. He's the lefty, and now he's quarterbacking for Washington. He has an excellent arm. I would say that Penix is a bit prone to some bad decisions, so you know, that is a little bit of a red flag. And how much of that is just coaching and system versus how much of that is with him, it's hard to know. But I know he has a good arm. I know he's an excellent runner, and I know that he can really put the ball in tight spots sometimes. So he's right now rated as the fourth of the four quarterbacks that are available in the first round, you know, for the Giants should they draft. So, and he's the one that I actually know a little bit about. I haven't seen enough of the other three to really make qualified assessments on. But even if somehow they had to, quote unquote, you know, only get Michael Penix, and there's no way the Giants should be in position to not be able to get one of the top four quarterbacks. So if this guy's really the worst of those four somehow, even that I think is going to be a fair and substantial upgrade over Daniel Jones. I would say 100% take him, even if we're limited to just Michael Penix. So he's got an excellent arm, and we're going to see. So the factors should include how high will the Giants draft and how good is each one of these college quarterbacks. And I think as the season goes on, and as more becomes clear with these quarterbacks, I might talk a little bit more about those college quarterbacks. In any case, the Giants have to choose a quarterback in the upcoming draft. The Giants always have a low ceiling, in my opinion, with Daniel Jones there. And I talked about it before. I talked about it today. Now is the time to rip off the damn band-aid and get an actual franchise quarterback in here, one that is capable of leading this goddamn Giants team. So, Joe Shane, you listening, Joe? All eyes are on you. And I don't care if this MRI reveals that Daniel Jones has, you know, a broken knee, a friggin' ACL that keeps him out for a year, or just Jones has a tiny little boo-boo on his knee. I don't friggin' care what this medical result says. I don't care. And Shane shouldn't care either. I have seen enough of Daniel Jones. The fans have seen enough of Daniel Jones. We all have. He can't stay healthy. He's not good enough when he is healthy. No more excuses. Go get yourself a goddamn quarterback. For the good of the franchise, Shane, do the right thing, and let's get a real quarterback. And that's it, guys. I want to thank you for listening to Jersey Guy Sports. Please subscribe to the podcast, tell your friends all about it, and I'll be back soon with some more sports talk. Thanks, and have a good day.